and we can start.
Good afternoon, everybody, and respected dignitaries, university officers, scientists, faculty, students, and all the audience, whoever seeing this heart talk streaming in electronic media. Myself, Dr. Sujata Avvaru, presently working in the university, that is Dr. YSR Horticulture University, situated in the Venkatramanna Gudem village of Tadepalli Gudem Mandal in West Godavari district of Andhra Pradesh. So I have put up nearly 35 years of service in this university in various cadres, and out of which my service is in 27 years of research, and my expertise is agricultural entomology and conducted research in biological control, mass culturing of bioagents to control the coconut pests, and also eco-friendly integrated pest management technologies of coconut and other horticultural crop pests. During my tenure of research, I could get more than 10 awards, which are at the state level, national level, and university level. And I have run nearly more than 10 externally funded projects from NATP, ICAR, APEDA, Coconut Development Board, and National Bee Board. And because of my expertise and experience on the biological control of coconut pests, I got the opportunity of 1 year deputation by the Government of India to work in Trinidad and Tobago Government of West Indies to work on a special project, that is biological control of red palm mite, which is a serious pest in that country. Then I moved to the administrative cadres as head of the institutes and associate dean of the college, and presently I am working as dean of student affairs of our college. Really, today I am very happy and feel proud to share this platform of Heart Talk by the Progressive Horticulture through the Professor Dr. Dwivedi to share the topic, that is honeybee and horticulture. I'll share my slides now. We can go through the subject. Prior to our topic, I would like to brief about our university. Just now, I have stated that this university was established in West Godavari district of Andhra Pradesh in the year of 2007, second of its kind in our country. And the main motto of our university is imparting quality education and human resource development and conducting need-based research, which is necessary to the problems of agriculture. And the other one is dissemination of proven technologies through extension agencies. And our education wing consists of 8 horticultural colleges, out of which 4 are affiliated, and diploma horticulture institutes, 11, out of which 7 are affiliated, which are spread over the entire state in different districts. We have got research stations 20 in different agroclimatic zones of the state. and conducting needful research, developing high yielding varieties, and rescuing the farmers through farmers' advisory cells and plant protection associations, which brought many laurels to our university through ICR by declaring as best AICRP centers. And in case of education also, we have excellent infrastructure facilities in our institute, which includes modern classrooms and well-equipped laboratories and student amenities like hostels, playgrounds, gymnasium, etc. Students also brought many laurels to our university by securing SRF seats and also awards in cultural and as well as educational career at university level and as agri university sports meets level. And in case of extension, we have 4 Krishi Vignan Kendras in 4 different zones of our Andhra Pradesh. And that KVKs are imparting training to the farmers on need-based technologies and developed technologies, suitable technologies to the farmers. And KVK with their team, they also brought laurels to the university by securing at zonal level and national level awards in serving the farming community. This is the brief about our university, and this supported me to work this much service and get many awards and do the many external funded projects for the development of the university. So then we will come into our topic, that is honeybees and horticulture. When we look into the sector of horticulture, it is nothing but a part of agricultural science that deals with the production, utilization, and improvement of fruits, vegetables, flowers, ornamentals, plantation crops, medicinal and aromatic plants. We know the fact that our world population, nearly 900 million people, are undernourished. So another fact also, we know that our Indian meals contain much of the horticultural crops and their produce in our diet. So in this context, I would like to remember few great words given by our eminent agriculture scientist, Professor M.S. Swaminathan. He has given excellent solution or focused in which sector can bring up this undernourished into the well-nourished sector. That is, due to rich content of vitamins, fibers, minerals, and antioxidants, these horticultural produce holds great nutritional significance. So horticulture alone can solve the malnutrition, undernutrition, and under hunger problems of India. So when you see the other part of our topic, that is honeybee, we know these honeybees are flying terrestrial creatures, and most of the honeybees belongs to the genus Apis and serving the mankind in many ways. When you look into our history, in ancient times, there is a mentioning about honeybees in our ancient scriptures, Vedas, and also Buddhist sacred writings. The first report of these honeybees we can see in the paintings of Madhya Pradesh in way back 11,000 BC itself. So owing to its importance or key role of honeybees in our ecosystem or mankind life. The governments have recognized or designated one day for remembering honeybees and declared as World Honeybee Day, which is being celebrated on May 20th of every year. So when this honeybee, how it is serving the mankind or global ecosystem, we will go to the into detail one by one. Really, it is a multifaceted potential creature which will work as in many ways. The number one, we can say it is a good forager. And for its foraging, it will visit different bee pasturages or these foraging ecosystems and benefiting the nature in many ways. And the other thing, it protects the plant diversity of different agro ecosystems. The other one is the pollinator. We know without pollination, there won't be seed production or yields or crop produces. So that much important role it shares for pollinating different crops. And then other important thing is, it is very good honey producer. While collecting nectar for breeding his young ones, it will provide honey to mankind also, which is a excellent nutrient assurance to all the mankind with so many ingredients in the honey. The other one is byproducts. So many byproducts from honey or beehive are also will give us nutrient assurance, and also it is useful in medicinal and different sectors of our nature. And in these ways, honeybees are helping the mankind. We will go one by one. When we look at the species composition of these honeybees, there are nearly about 10 species in the nature, but they differ one with the other in their size and in their habitat visiting and in their morphological characters. So we can see these pictures, Apis serena indica and Apis dorsata, Apis mellifera, Trigona iridipennis, and Apis floria. And the other ones also, Apis laboriosa and Apis newlyensis. Please, previous slide, please. And the Apis andriniformis and Apis nigrosincta, likewise. Among these 10, 5 species are more prominent in our nature. So when we go to the details of this body structure of honeybees, they are specially architectured, especially mouth parts and 3 pairs of its legs, which suits for the collection of pollen and honey and pollination. So we will see one by one. When we see the front legs, that is prolex, there will be eye brush and pollen brush and antenna cleaner, that is nothing but strigils. In the second pair of legs, those are middle legs, will be or provided with pollen brush, tibial spur. And the hind legs will contain pollen basket or corbicula and pollen packer and pollen comb. So these things we can visualize, we can see how it is using its body hairs on the head or on different parts, and its legs, for we can see the hairs on the head and on the legs, and the brushes on these legs and the pollen combs, and how it is visiting flowers. And during this visit, while collecting pollen grains, so all the pollen grains which are adhered to the these body parts will be again passed on to the these parts of the legs. We can see how many number of pollen grains are there on the leg, on the head, and these pollen grains will be transmitted into the pollen basket, which is situated in the hind legs. So then, like this, after getting full of pollen grains in the pollen baskets in the hind legs, it will move on to the hive with these loads of pollen grains. So again, it visits the another flower for getting honey and pollen grains. So these are the in detailed pictures of four legs. You can see antenna cleaner and brush on the leg part, and in the middle leg we can see brush, and in the hind legs we can see the pollen basket and comb. So these are the specially modified legs which benefits honeybee as well as the mankind. The other part of honeybee's life is bee pasturage. Bee pasturage is nothing but plants that yield pollen and nectar are collectively called as bee pasturage, and the forage refers to the collection of nectar and pollen grains by the bees. So for this pasturage, bee pasturage, different ecosystems will serve as a bee pasturage. Those are horticulture, agricultural crops, agroforestry, wild and weed species that are available in the agricultural fields and wastelands. Thus, it will visit all these ecosystems, and finally, while visiting, this will protect by transferring the pollen grains for pollination to one plant species to another plant species, which will finally helps us conservation of this biological diversity in the nature. So we can see the different ecosystems which serves as bee pasturage. We can see goats, vegetables, aqua ecosystem and paddy ecosystem, and these are the plantation crops that also serves as bee pasturage. And we can see abundant of flowers, so many from vegetables, fruits, which can serve as bee forage. And among these crops, we have different groups of plants which are rich in nectar, pollen, and some are rich in both nectar and pollen. Here we can see plants that are rich in nectar: tamarind, neem, soapnut, eucalyptus, pungam, moringa, prosopis, and glycidia and tribulus species. So these are one group of plant that will serve as source for nectar to the honeybees. And the other group of plants which are rich in pollen will serve as a pollen source to the bee forage. So among these crops, sorghum, maize, millets like kumbu and tenai, varugu, roses, pomegranate, sweet potato, tobacco, coconut, castor, date palm, and oil palm. These are rich in pollen, and thus they will serve for the pollen source. So other group of plants which are having both pollen and nectar, and they will serve as the source for both. Those comes under plants: banana, citrus, apple, berries, pear, plum, peach, guava, sunflower, and safflower, mango, and cashew. So how these all these are the groups of plants which provide nectar and pollen to the bees. How they will collect nectar from the plants, we will see here. So pollen will be nectar will be present in the base of the plant, that is the gynoecium, female part of the flower. From there, the honeybee passes its tongue, which is modified for collection of the nectar, that is lapping type of tongue, will pass into that female part and collects the nectar and passes it to the hive bees. And these hive bees, after collecting nectar, it will passes the collected nectar between pre-oral cavity and its tongue to ripen the honey, and later it will move to the bee comb. There it drops this nectar into the bee cell, comb cell, after preparing it as honey. Similarly, it will collect pollen grains from the flowers, which are male part of the flowers. And one flower after one flower, it will visit and collect the pollen. Just now we have witnessed how it will collect, and pollen grains stick on to its body, and by using its pollen comb, it will pack into the corbicula, that is pollen basket, and it will dislodge this pollen into the comb cell with the help of middle legs. A single bee can carry nearly about 10 to 30 milligrams, that comes nearly 1/4 of the bee's weight every time when it visits to beehive. So after collecting this pollen, these bees will mix these pollen grains with a little bit of honey and prepare bee bread and store in the comb cells. This one, the other important character or benefit to the mankind from the bees, plant diversity protection. Here, pollination is really a wonderful process and a vital process for supporting our plant diversity and all associated organisms in the food chain of life, including the sustainability of agriculture and human food security. And here again, pollinators, nothing but honeybees, are a key component for our global biodiversity, which providing us a vital ecosystem services to horticulture and agricultural crops and wild plants. Thus, honeybees serves as plant diversity protectors. So then the other important character is pollinator. Pollination is nothing but transfer of pollen grains, that is male part of the flower, to a female part of the flower. So in this, again, pollination, there are two types of pollination. One is cross pollination, that is also called as allogamy, and where this pollen grains are delivered to a female part of a different plant flower, that is called cross pollination. And in case of self pollination, the pollen grains of one flower pollinates the same female part of the flower or on the same flower on the same plant. So we can see for a few seconds regarding how the bee pollinates by moving from one flower to another flower. So by carrying pollen grains on its body parts. See how this honeybee is collecting pollen grains. These are the pollen grains stick onto its body parts, and it is carried to the next flower and pollinated it and gone. So in this way, so pollination has got a great contribution for Indian plants, which comes around nearly 90% of world's food from that plants, and that is comes to a 3/4 of our plant populations in the nature. And every third spoon of food we will get through pollination only. That means a third of world's food production really depends on the bee pollination. So by the pollination of bees, our crop yields could increase up to 25% according to the reports. So in detail, if you go, the still further benefits of pollination. Generally, bees will visit crops for getting their food for their young ones in the form of pollen grains and nectar. And by doing that, they are helping to get the pollinated of the crop plants. And thereby, due to this pollination, crops are being benefited in many ways. Those are the yields of seed and fruit are increased in different folds when compared to the non-pollinated or closed cropped areas. And it improves quality of fruits and seeds. And it also increases oil content of seeds in sunflower. In some cases, where self-pollination is incompatible crops, in that case, bee pollination is an essential one. If we see the different groups of plants which are benefited by the bee pollination, under fruit crops, almond, apple, apricot, peach, strawberry, citrus, lychee, these are all the fruit crops which are benefited by the bee pollination. Under vegetable crops, cabbage, cauliflower, carrot, coriander, cucumber, melon, onion, pumpkin, radish and turnip comes under this group. In case of oil seed crops, sunflower, rape seed, mustard, safflower and ginger leaf, they are benefited by pollination. And in forage crops, lucerne and clover are the crops which are benefited by the pollination. And when we look into the yield increase, we can see here, as per the records, mustard crop yields increased by 43% and sunflower yields increased nearly 48%. And in case of cotton, 17% to 19%, in a major increase or maximum increase we can see in onion crop, that is 112% increase in the yields. In apple crop, 93% increase. When you see details of the pollination impact in vegetable crops, certain vegetable crops, carrot crop, protandry is the more prevalent nature. That means male part of the flower will mature well in advance, and by the time gynoecium matures, that is female part matures, the pollen won't be available. In that case, it is cross-pollination is an essential phenomenon. So pollinators are very, very important for carrot pollination. And by that, the seeds per plant increased, and seeds per plant increased by 5 times in this crop. Similarly, in coal crops, here self-sterility is there. That means the female part is incompatible to receive the pollen from the same flower in the crops like whole crops, that is cabbage, cauliflower and Brussels. So in this condition also bee pollination is essential. So because of bee, the Apis serena indica is the major visitor of these whole crops, and because of this pollination, pod setting, number of seeds and seed weight has been increased. And in turnip and radish crop, here also similar case, self incompatible, which demands cross pollination from by external agents like honeybees. So because of these honeybees pollination, here mean pod length, number of seeds per pod and weight of seeds per plant and as well as per hectare yields also will be increased in many folds because of this bee pollination. In case of okra, it is self-sterile. That means here, it is self-fertile. Even though it is self-fertile, to certain extent, that is 4 to 18% cross-pollination will occur in these crops. So because of this cross-pollination, the fruit or these seed number and capsule weight and length in the fruits will be increased. In the onion crop also, protandry is the crop's feature where cross-pollination is an essential. By this cross-pollination, onion seed weight hence the transfer of pollen from one flower to another flower is essential, and where external agents like honeybees are required. Here also, because of this cross pollination, seed number, seed fruit weight and yields were increased. In case of cruciferous oil seeds, here also seed yield increased to a greater extent because of this bee pollination. In apple crop, there is a correlation or relation among honeybee population visited the flowers and because of inadequate pollination in apple crop or lack of pollination will result in flowers, fruit drop in immature stage itself and misshaped fruits. Similar is the case with almond gardens also, where cross pollination is essential. So when we see in stone fruit crops like apricot, cherry, peach and plum, there is lot of increase in fruit set as well as in yield per tree in open field when compared to the enclosed fields. So we can see here in case of apricot, fruit set was 19% and yield per tree was 19 kg when compared to that of enclosed, that is 67 kg per plant yield. Likewise, in case of cherry also, so enclosed field fruit setting is 2%, whereas in open field 36% where cross pollination occurred. And fruit yield in enclosed one 2%, whereas in open field it is 35 kg per tree. Likewise, in peach we can see maximum fruit crop in open field, that is 216 fruits per tree against 155. And fruit set also, 26 against 22 fruits in enclosed. Likewise, we can see the highest yields per tree and highest fruit set in different crops. So similar is the case with apple, strawberry, cherry and pear and peach crops. We can see enclosed gardens yield and whereas open field yields. So in case of coffee also, this cross pollination by the bees improves the yield in quantity as well as in quality. And the other important phenomena that could be observed in coffee crop is the synchronicity improved and uniformity of fruit set also improved, so that reducing the harvesting and sorting out costs of the farmers. So not only this pollination culturing bees in the gardens itself, there is a commercial way of hiring the beehives, that is keeping the beehives in the gardens for a shorter period on hire basis and also for longer period, which is the main important practice is being in practice in apple and almond gardens, where the price varies from $60 per hive to shorter period, in longer period $190, depending on the situations. So other beneficial character of our honeybee is producing honey. So prepared by collecting nectar from the flowers, it prepares honey and feeds its young ones as well as provides to the mankind. This is really a wonderful, excellent, nutrient rich food, a high quality food. So not only this honey, the other bee products, that is royal jelly and pollen and hive products like bee wax, propolis, bee venom, all these we are getting from the honeybee. We can see how they collect honey and how they prepare honey, how they fill the comb cells in beehive with the honey. After getting the honey, they will fill it in the comb cells, and after filling that honey in that, they will seal the cells. Here it is dislodging pollen grains from its hind legs with the help of middle legs into the comb cells, and after dislodging they will mix these pollen grains with the little bit honey, prepare bee bread, which is a good fruit food to the bee young ones. Those are bee larvae which are growing in the comb cells. Thus they will provide food to their young ones by bringing honey and also pollen grains from different ecosystems by their foraging. So regarding commercial value of honey, here it is nearly, we are marketing $500 million annually. So there is an expectation it would go up to 1130 million dollars by the year 2025. Our honorable Prime Minister Sri Narendra Modi ji has a great vision, with a great vision announced Sweet Revolution. Sweet Revolution is nothing but improving the production of honey. That Sweet Revolution is really a strategic step to increase the honey production in the country, and this is a major contributor for doubling the income of the farmers. The constituents of the honey, when we go into the details, it is a viscous sweet fluid produced by honey. How it will be produced, we have already seen. And after collecting the nectar from the flower base, and also extra floral parts, it will collect this nectar, and from fruit juices and cane juices, the nectar will be collected. And we can see this nectar contains nearly 20 to 40% sucrose when it is collected in the plant cells. Later, these honeybees mix this nectar with invertase enzyme, which is present in the saliva of honeybee, and converts this sucrose into dextrose and levulose, which are simplified sugars. And after converting into honey, by passing it between its chewing tongue and preoral cavity, the honeycomb cells will be filled with honey. After that, they will fan the all honey-filled comb cells with their wings to evaporate the water from the honey and to ripen the honey. This is called honey ripening. And after that, they will seal the honey cells. So from this, we have seen that contents of the honey, it is prepared by the honeybees by mixing with enzymes in its saliva. Those enzymes are invertase, diastase, and glucose. Mixing with the nectar will be resulting in the honey. And in case of pollen also, it is very rich in protein, lipid, and micronutrients like minerals. We will go into the further details. There we can come to know that really honey is an excellent nutrient assurance to the mankind with its valuable ingredients. So the composition of honey it will contain 41% of fructose sugar and 35% of glucose, that is dextrose, and that 20 to 40% sucrose, which was there in nectar, has come down to 1.9% content in this honey. It was so made by the honeybee's saliva. And dextrins, 1.5%. And minerals, to an extent of 2%. Water, 17%. And little bit enzymes, vitamins, etc., pigments will be at 1.6% in the honey. When we look into the uses of honey or benefits of honey in different sectors or different fields, we can understand how much a valuable product honey is. This is a good healthy food, we know, with all these minerals, vitamins, and sugars. It is a good skin moisturizer and antiseptic agent. And with this, it serves as an akin remover also. And honey is an energy booster and immune system booster. And when you take honey, it improves the blood flow. And also it's a good for treatment of sore throat and a good remedy for burns. It has got antibacterial nature and very relaxed relaxant for anxiety, and it is a good preventive medicine for cancer and heart diseases. So not only honey, the other byproducts of the honeybee, that is royal jelly, pollen, wax, we will go one by one. These are royal jelly is secreted by the hypopharyngeal glands of the worker bees, and this will be given as a food to queen larva. And this really a dietary supplement for humans claiming various health benefits, which is having its composition 12.5% crude protein and little bit of different amino acids, 11% simple sugars, that is monosaccharides, high amount of, that is 5% of fatty acids and minerals. And the uses of this or benefits of this royal jelly, when we see, so it has got greater role in medicinal sector. So it can be used as a stimulant for the growth of glial cells and neuron stem cells in the brain. And it serves as a cholesterol lowering agent, anti-inflammatory agent, wound healing capacity it has got, and antibiotic effects it has got. And in case of pollen, it is collected from the male part of the flowers we have seen. This will contain 55% carbohydrates, 35% proteins, and 3% minerals and vitamins, 2% fatty acids, and 5% of other components. So these pollen produces can be utilized. That is, we have already discussed about bee bread, how it is prepared by the honeybee, and that is used in naturopathic medicine and as other nutritional supplement also. The other important beehive product is beeswax. It is secreted by worker bees and used to build the combs, beehive combs. And these can be used for preparing comb foundation sheets, which are the part and the parcel of honey beehives. And this purified and bleached beeswax can also be used in food, cosmetics, and pharmaceuticals. And it can also be used in candle preparation and shoe polish and furniture polish. The other is bee venom. This is actually that chemical substance that is injected when bee hits man by intruding its ovipositor. This bee venom can be given as a shot for the treatment of rheumatoid arthritis, nerve pain, multiple sclerosis, and also for swollen tendons. The other product is propolis. Propolis is a resinous mixture that honeybees collects from the tree buds and sap of the flowers and other botanical plant sources. Generally, bees use this for sealant in repairing of beehive cells in the bee comb. And it can also serve as this propolis as natural medicine for various conditions, that is including inflammation, viral diseases, ulcers, and superficial burns. So these are the benefits we are getting from the honeybees. Having known all these important benefits from the bees, and also the key role honeybees are playing in human life and also different ecosystems, it is our prime responsibility to protect bees and conserve the bees and bee pasturages. The farming community, while doing different plant protection operations in these pasturages or bee ecosystems, whatever it may be, agricultural or horticulture, they must be very, very careful and meticulous in using the implementing the plant protection measures. Because of this improved technology in agriculture practices, climate change or disasters or beehive collapses or some parasites and diseases of bees, bee population has come down drastically. So to create bee friendly ecosystems, we the scientists and farming community should follow the eco-friendly plant protection measures that can be termed as nothing but integrated pest management or bio-intensive integrated pest management. That is nothing but ecosystem-based strategy which focuses on long-term prevention of pests or their damage by using a combination of different techniques such as biological control, habitat manipulation, modification of cultural practices, and use of resistant varieties. So the modules of this IPM should contain these tools or these components. Those are cultural methods, physical methods, mechanical methods, biological methods. That means using biological agents to control the pests on the crops, and using botanical pesticides for controlling the pests or diseases, and bee-friendly or safe chemical pesticides on need-based as a last resort. So our cultural methods includes, that is, collection and destruction of pest-infested or disease-infected planting material, and rotating the crops instead of going for the monocrops, which increases the pest load in that crop, rotating the crops one crop after season by season or year after, it is always best to keep the insect pests or diseases at lower level for avoiding the chemical pesticides which are harmful to the bees. In the similar way, to have crop assurance, farmer can go for multiple cropping at a time, many crops with different nutrient backgrounds. And similarly, intercropping. In a certain ratio, they have to grow two or three types of crops so that the minimizing the pest load and ultimately less uses of chemical pesticides. Border crops, likewise, trap crops, which can be sown well in advance to attract the insects or diseases, and those crops can be destroyed when pest load on that, and protecting the main crop without using pesticides. And deep plowing in summer will expose many insect stages and eaten by the predators, so that minimizing the usage of pesticides. And the, likewise, disease resistant or pest resistant seed material, certified material from known source, and giving regular irrigations, timely irrigations, to avoid the stress conditions to the crop. If crop condition is under stress, all these pests will get attracted to the crop and necessitating the plant protection measures. So good horticultural practices we need to practice. So all these comes under cultural methods by which we can avoid usage of chemicals in our ecosystems. So this is nothing but collection and destruction of infested planting materials. So I have told just now that multiple crop, how it looks. And these are the intercrops. These are the barrier crops, which serves as barriers for entering the flying insects as well as small sucking pest complex without entering the main field and protecting the main crop without using pesticides. And these are the trap crops. These will also serve our purpose for minimizing the pest control activities. So plowing, deep summer plowing will expose insect stages and get predated by crows and other predators. So timely irrigation is also important to maintain the crop situation with minimum pest load or without getting pests. These are the comes under good agricultural practices, collection of infested plant material and destruction timely. Then mechanical comes under that hand picking of larvae, caterpillars or pest stages and destroying them without using chemicals in the crop. This mulching also helps without weed growth in the field so that we can avoid weedicides spraying in the crop and which will help us or give us bee friendly ecosystem in our cropping systems. We can see here sticky traps. This will get attracted all the small flying pests, that is sucking pests, thrips, white flies. Such type of pests can be get attracted to the sticky traps and it can be destroyed without using chemical pesticides. Similarly, pheromone traps. These will help for getting attraction of the adult flying moths and so that we can eliminate the egg laying in the main crop of that insect pest and there is no need of using pesticides. Similarly, light traps. All the insects, adults, which are harmful or which are coming into the crop to lay the eggs can be get attracted to the light trap and they can be trapped in different methods and destroyed at one time so that we can avoid insects in the crop fields. So these are other type of different types of pheromone traps in different cropping situations. So we have mentioned about biocontrol agents. These biocontrol agents are different types. They are insects, they are viruses, they are fungus, bacteria, and nematodes. So these will feed on the insect pests which are causing harm to the crops and they will destroy the crop pests in different stages and thus helping us not to use chemical pesticides. These biocontrol agents also can be mass multiplied in the laboratories and can be released at a time on the depending on the type of pest in that cropped area. And these biological agents, these parasites will destroy the crop pests and thus these are helpful for us to eliminate chemical pesticides in the cropping area. These are the different type of bio agents. We are also seeing many predators in our ecosystems, in agriculture and horticulture ecosystems. We know that spiders, coccinellids, that is ladybird beetles, mantids, and chrysopids, wasps, ants, earbigs, all these comes under the natural enemies of insect pests, which cause damage to the crops. So if we conserve these predators in our ecosystems, without using chemical pesticides. These will take care of the pests and they will keep at minimum level and give us healthy crops. So these are some of the predators we can see on different crops. So all this is about the honeybees in and horticulture. As a part of sweet revolution or responsibility to protect or protect the honeybees or improve the scientific apiculture, government of India has been providing or sanctioning many projects to all state agriculture universities, horticulture universities and departments and also NGOs in financing for establishing the bee promoting activities in different fields. Likewise, Dr. YSR Horticulture University has also got sanctioned one project that is Integrated Beekeeping Development Center. That is nothing but Center of Excellence on Beekeeping. Funding from National Bee Board, Government of India. This project has been sanctioned to the Dr. YSR Horticulture University in the year 2017 and 18, with a budget sanctioning of nearly 106.15 lakhs. And with this funding, in the university, we could do many bee promoting and bee apiculture strengthening activities. That is, beekeeping units we have established in the university campus and conducted many training programs to the beekeeping farmers in different districts of Andhra Pradesh. Each training for 7 days by giving lectures and showing demos and showing the beehive boxes and conducting exposure visits, thus creating awareness among the farmers and creating interest and inspiring farmers to do the apiculture. And state level seminar was also organized in the university by inviting all the apiculture farmers, scientists and different parts of the Andhra Pradesh and the eminent scientists and also resource persons have given lectures for the benefit of the bee farmers. We have established honey quality control laboratory in the university and honey bee disease diagnostic laboratory in the university and honey extraction unit, honey processing unit, and we are at it for establishment of the beehive manufacturing units. So likewise, we have attempted so many activities as a part of IBDC activities. Our university has distributed beehive boxes to the farming societies, that is TSP, FPGs, with the funding of MIDH and IBDC project and state horticulture department. After giving 7 days training program, we have distributed beehive boxes at the rate of 50 boxes for unit or for association. So these are the visuals of different lectures to the bee farmers during training period. And this university has also conducted Honeybee Day celebration to recognize the honeybees' importance and creating awareness among the student community by conducting rallies and exhibiting placards and invited guest lectures to the bee farmers. With all these activities, we have conducted Honeybee Day. in the university. So finally, we have come to know how important bees are, how these creatures are integral part of most ecosystems, and how the bee is playing its key role in a multidimensional way. So keeping all this in our mind, so it's our prime responsibility to save the bee or to protect the bee and to conserve the bee pasturages and honeybee population. For that, we need to maintain the bee pasturages with bee-friendly flowers or pollinator gardens, or maintaining the bee pasturages for healthy, safe foraging of honeybees. And we should avoid these toxic chemicals while doing our plant protection measures in agricultural and horticulture ecosystems. And we need to provide shelter for bees and promoting the scientific beekeeping. And really today we know that beekeeping is an important, sustainable, integral agricultural activity under the Rural Development Program in India, as it provides nutritional, economic, and ecological security and balance. So this is the time we need to remember the more valuable words or great quotes given by the eminent scientist Albert Einstein. Knowing the importance of honeybees, he presented these words. Those are, if the bee disappeared off the surface of the globe, quote given by the scientist, that is, the bee's life is like a magic well. The more you draw from it, the more it fills with water. So the more we conserve the bees, we take attention and of the bees, the more we pay the interest, the more the benefits we can derive from the honeybees in the nature. So finally, we need to remember these words: save honeybees and save mankind and earth. So I am very much thankful, and my due acknowledgments to the Georgia Technological Institute of USA, having utilized videos from their source. And also, I am gratefully acknowledging the team of Progressive Horticulture through Dr. Divedi and our university, which is being directed and led by the able leadership of our Honorable Vice Chancellor Dr. Toleti Janaki Ram Garu, and all my colleagues and all my departmental staff and technicians for giving me this opportunity, for arranging this platform to present this important topic, that is honeybees and horticulture. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, ma'am. If any person has query, they can send by mail. I already put it on the mail. Your mail is on the scrolling by the banner, so they will send. If they have any query,
so any time is left for discussion, interaction?
No, we don't have. If anybody has query, they will send mail on your mail. I'm already mailing.
Okay, please share with me saved document.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you, Shivji, very much.
Thank you.
You can give your impression.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Now,